welcome to the MBS Show, episode number 7. Lucky number 7. Yes, I'm your host, Norman Sanzo, and joining me today is Emilio Daniels. Emilio? You there? Emilio? Okay. Emilio's not here. And joining me today is Joey Chua! Joey? You there? Oh, looks like I'm handling the show by myself today. Okay. I think I have a guest. Yes, I have a guest. This show is not completely wasted. Okay, my guest is Daniel J. Christie Jude Valentine Anthony, or better known as Daniel.
Hi.
Ah, there you are. I'm not alone.
All right.
So how was your day, Daniel?
Oh, my day was pretty good. Weather was pretty up and down, you know, rain all of a sudden in the evening. I was drying all my clothes outside my house, suddenly, boom.
So was not a good day for you then?
No, it was okay. I don't usually grade my days based on the weather because, you know, that's not the right way to do it. Every time I tell my friends to, you know, stay inside on the weather, doesn't mean, you know, you sit inside all day and sleep. Do something important, do something productive, like go a night gag, you know.
That's productive?
Laughter's the best medicine, so yeah, indirectly it's productive.
So, before we start the show, I got 4 important questions for you. Question number 1 is, who's your favorite pony?
Okay, I believe you asked me this before, you know, sometime outside, so I like to break it, as I said, into 3 parts, because, come on, I can't have a favorite pony. There's so many of them. They're all lovable. That's the reason why I watch MLP. Otherwise, I'll only watch episodes with my favorite pony in it.
True, true.
And then it'll be called My Little Pinkie, you know. Wouldn't matter.
Your favorite pony's Pinkie?
If you count only the main 6, because if you go non-main 6, I like Cheerilee.
Oh, okay.
You know the teacher pony, yeah.
Yeah, she's like popular.
For some reason, yeah. She's got a great smile. If it's just within the main 6, I would say it's gotta be Pinkie, because I'm like Pinkie in so many ways. And if you don't know, I'm a balloon decorator on the side. I came to work for Sugar Cube Corner.
Oh, cool. So do you have a party cannon?
Oh, yes, I have 2, in fact.
That's how you do it?
Yep.
So you said you have 3. So Pinkie Pie, Cheerilee, and
the last one is when people ask me which is my favorite foal. Favorite filly. And a lot of people think I would choose one from the CMC because the CMC is so popular. But no, I'm very, very hipster. I choose Twist.
Okay,
she's a real hipster. You know the glasses that look, that's really, really hipster.
Well, they came out of left field. Well, it's Pinkie Pie, Cheerilee, and Twist. I was not expecting Twist.
Okay, a lot of people don't expect it. Some people hate me for it.
I don't hate you.
Never mind, haters gonna hate.
What's your favorite episode?
Yeah, this I also like to divide into 3 parts.
Okay.
I'm kidding. Okay, well, it's been changing recently a lot, and my latest favorite, I have to say, has got to be A Friend Indeed.
A Friend Indeed.
The Pinkie episode with Cranky Doodle.
Ah, okay, cool.
Before that, it happened to me that all the episodes that I like featured the ponies that I disliked the most. Like, last time I didn't really like Rarity, and Twilight Sparkle, I didn't really like the 2 of them. But my favorite episode was Lesson 0.
That one was a great episode.
That was a really good episode. That used to be my favorite. Then, of course, after that, when Pinkie won my heart again, I couldn't say no.
How do you become a fan of the show?
That was a long story, actually, because a lot of people ask me, especially after I become a Brony, and Bronies ask me, oh, did you go through the common 4 steps, or did I spend my time on 4chan or something? It's actually none of the above. I used to be a very big fan of, I don't know if you know about the Care Bear series.
I have heard of them. They are almost like the ponies, but not that great.
Yeah, true. They're very similar, because what happened is, in 2011, last year, my choir and I sing in a choir, we went to Vietnam for an international competition where we competed against other choirs around the world. And we were actually one of the very perky fellas. We couldn't shut up. We were always making noise, always smiling. And, you know, when they always tell us, guys, you know, we all were talking backstage and they really like you all. And suddenly from the backstage, you hear the whole choir going, oh! That's when, you know, we got the nickname, the Care Bear Choir. That's when I came back and I was like, it calls the Care Bear Choir. I haven't watched Care Bears in years. So I decided to turn it on. And that's when I actually got interested in Care Bears. I started watching it. And bear in mind, this was in 2011, already after MLP was launched. But I had no idea about MLP because at that time, the thing stuck in my head was still G3.5. I'm like, crap, I'm not going to watch that.
Okay.
So I was stuck with the Care Bears. And unfortunately, the Care Bears series ended in the early 2010. It ended, there was no more episodes, and I finished watching, and after that I continued re-watching the episodes from season 1 and season 2 of Care Bears over and over again. And of course eventually I got bored, and that's when suddenly I started switching over to YouTube Poop, if you heard of that stuff.
Yes, I heard on your last episode of your podcast, but we'll get into that later.
Yeah, YouTube poop is all those funny videos on YouTube people make. It's not vandalism, it's in a way making things more entertaining by taking things out of context. And I looked around for Care Bears poop, but Care Bears also has the generation gap thingy. When you watch Care Bears back in the 1980s, they were very fluffy, they were very, they were that kind of cuddly, very look like teddy bears kind of thing. And then the reboot that I used to watch, they were very smooth, looking very CGI. They even had CGI episodes in complete 3D computer graphics. It kind of killed the show, it kind of killed the feel, but the character was still there. And what happened is, I watched YouTube poop for a Care Bear episode, and they reused a bit of a Care Bear meme which happened, and I was suddenly seeing ponies on the screen arguing. It was actually Rainbow Dash and Fluttershy in the first scene of Sonic Rainbow, the scene that is most abused in YouTube
yeah.
poop episode.
Oh, okay.
Abuse like crazy, you know, when Fluttershy says yay, they put either, you know, I'm a foreign Malaysia.
Okay.
That's when I was like, what show is this? I need to see this. It's cute. It looks interesting. I really, really need to see this. So, of course, I start scrolling down and YouTube comments reveal so many things. And that's when I saw My Little Pony Friendship is Magic. I'm like, no, can't be that. It looks too anime. Because of the eyes, you know the eyes, the pony's eyes, they're very...
Very big.
Very big and very distinct. So I was like, okay, I'll give this show a try. And that's when I watched my first episode, which was Call of the Cutie, the Apple Bloom episode. It was the first episode I ever watched. And I looked, it was so similar. Ponies had cutie marks, Care Bears had belly badges. What was on their belly that represented what they stand for. They get it from birth, while ponies get it at puberty, we say.
Okay.
Or when they discover their secret talent. So that's how it all started. I started watching, and it wasn't like, as I said, going through the five stages. As soon as I watched it, because of how similar it was to Care Bears, bang, I was a Brony from the first episode I ever watched.
That was a long story, but an interesting story.
Yeah, that's why I'm hipster like that.
What do your families and friends think about your love for the show?
Where do you want me to start, family or friends?
Pick your poison. Doesn't really matter.
My parents think I'm mad.
Okay.
Because, I mean, they know about me watching Care Bears and then watching cartoons, and suddenly I'm back and I borrow my mom's iPad and I start watching My Little Pony, and parents are like, what the hell's wrong with you, man? You're 20 years old! And I'm saying that there's nothing wrong with this. This is a good show. My parents aren't probably very versed in the cartoon industry because they think I'm childish for watching Simpsons as well. And I said, oh, you haven't seen Simpsons.
Simpsons is not child-friendly.
You know, Simpsons, Futurama, and all those shows. Oh, no. They have that old-school perception where cartoons are for kids, or just kids alone.
Your friends?
Well, it depends how many of them welcome me. A lot of them think I'm gay. You know, the usual,
yay!
Damn, Daniel's gay. I've come across as a very feminine person since I was 15, and my favorite color has been pink for years. Even before I knew about My Little Pony, my Twitter nickname has always been Saint Pinkie. P-I-N-K-I-E, not P-I-N-K-Y, or anything like that. I've always spelt it like that, even before I was a Brony, even before G3 came out. As you know, with many Brony stories, Bronification stories, as soon as you just give them a little bit of a taste, people have actually watched episodes when I asked them to, and some of them have honestly told me they don't like it. But the ones that like it, they're stuck. I bronified one of my pen pals in Portugal over MSN. I asked her to watch. And of late, I bronified a Filipino girl over Twitter because she was asking, what is this with, you know, guys liking My Little Pony? And I sent her a link. Watch, see for yourself. She owes it to me for her Brony life now.
Friend reaction is a mixed bag then.
Very, very mixed.
In today's news topic, update on Lauren Faust's auction. Links in the show notes. It's been a week since we reported on Lauren Faust's pony concept art auction, and here are the results. G1 Pegasus Firefly got $1,366. Celestia Post Guide got $18,000.
$18,000, I can buy a car.
I'm not used to the American saying. I'm trying to cater to our American audience. So it's what, $1,800, right?
$1,800, yeah.
Okay, $1,800. And G1 Pegasus Medley, right?
Medley,
okay. Medley is at $2,675. Pinkie Pie Post Guide is at $3,100.
Yep, you got it right.
Okay, $3,100. And
get ready for this. You won't believe this price.
Twilight Sparkle Post Guide. The final price is $9,100. My God, the price. Well, it is for a good cause.
Yeah, it's great. It's something that we look on to, because when I first saw these auctions, I'm like, what? Are these people mad? Are they paying so much for a drawing? And that's before it hit me that they were originals from Lauren Faust collection. I thought they were like photo stand or deviant art projects.
No. These are originals. And, well, here's the thing. I thought that maybe Firefly would get a much higher response because, like, she is the predecessor to Rainbow Dash.
Yeah, but, you know, okay, G1 is the predecessor, but we all know, and we all sadly cannot doubt that her reputation was tarnished by G3. Most people, you ask them, well, where did the concept for Rainbow Dash come from? If bronies don't do their research or do their homework, they're most likely going to still think it's the G3 Rainbow Dash.
Have you read the fanfic, The Third Generation?
No, I heard of it, but I haven't read it.
It's a really good fic. What it does is, they import G3 ponies, Rainbow Dash and Pinkie Pie, to G4 world.
Ah, I see.
And the thing is, they don't only import the names, they import the ponies and change them into G4 style.
Ah, I've seen some of the drawings of that.
So you'll have G4 Earth Pony Rainbow Dash, but with nicer mane, nicer everything, but no wings.
The G3 Rainbow Dash should actually evolve into what's Rarity right now.
Yes.
Because in G3, one episode it was mentioned Princess Rarity. And
yeah. And
when people saw that, they almost puked because it was like, what the hell?
But Princess Rarity in the fanfic is a filly and, well, it's just an import
Princess
of...
Princess Rarity was very young. That's the thing.
Yeah.
Because they retained the word princess as the daughter of the queen. Like, yeah. The same way that Lauren Faust intended Celestia, that's why it just says Celestia Post Guide, because Lauren Faust intended Celestia to be Queen Celestia, but what happened in the studio is that they told her Queen tends to be associated with evil. Think Snow White, the evil queen. That's why they decided to go with Princess. Princess appeals more to girls, little girls, and it also, it's cuter, and it's much more, you know, it sounds much nicer.
Personally, I would like her to be Queen because it's a step up, but Princess, you can do a lot, and we have a lot of Princess Celestias.
Yep.
So anyway, the fanfic was pretty good. You should take a read. It's an interesting read.
Yeah, okay, sure. I'll take a read on that. Thanks for that.
And G1 Pegasus Medley. Medley, right?
Medley, yeah. Okay. I've heard of her, but not much, actually.
I don't really know about her. Here's the thing about ponies that I like. They have this back history of characters they can recycle.
Yeah.
And they can just bring in new ones every time they like. If a creative person like say, I want to use this pony named Kimono. Uh-huh. And then like, oh yeah, we can do that. She's an earth pony or something like that. I think like, wow.
A similar thing happened. I mean, coming back to the Care Bears fandom, some very similar things happened. Because when Care Bears came, a lot of OCs came out. And actually, if you look at the list, every Care Bear has been documented. There's no such thing as a background Care Bear.
Hmm, really no.
In the whole series, every single Care Bear, there's been three cases, only three, of three unidentified Care Bears. It's only ever been three. There's no such thing as a background Care Bear. Every Care Bear has a belly badge. Every Care Bear can be identified from it. And, of course, the fandom has gone on their own and made their own OCs. Back in the 1980s, when they still had a place called the Forest of Feelings, that's when they had other animals like monkeys, lions, elephants, and dogs. I
love Braveheart.
Oh yes, Braveheart rocks. That guy's gangster.
Never mind, let's move on.
Yep.
Pinkie Pie's post guide. Well, actually, it's just Pinkie Pie sprinkles on her cupcakes.
I'd pay for that, but not 3100, no.
And the most expensive of all is Twilight.
I actually expected Celestia's one to go higher.
I know!
Yeah, because, you know, of course, everybody loves Twilight.
Okay, the thing is, with Twilight, she's just sitting down reading a book. But with Celestia's pose, you got her standing, triumphant.
But think about this, everybody loves Twilight. if anyone goes through their list of ponies that they like, Twilight is definitely there. Even if she's at the bottom of it, she's always there.
My main six love guide has her in the top three.
Mine's at the bottom. I don't like her OCD, but that's just me.
Why? I like that. I mean, like, it gives her a flaw so that she's normal.
Yeah, it's true.
And talking about Twilight, hashtag Twilight Alicia shirt on eBay. Nice segue. Well, it's not really a segue if I say it out. Anyway, our Twittering pony, Tara Strong, has placed an exclusive pony t-shirt for us to bid on eBay. All of the sale will be given to the Children's Hospital and Research Center Foundation. As of this recording, the price of the shirt is at $810.
And it's not going any lower. $810 for a shirt, I mean, yeah.
if you would like to place a bid for the shirt yourself, you can go to the link in the show notes. But if you would like to donate to the Children's Hospital and Research Center Foundation, you can go to www.chofoundation.org.
Do something just like, you know, Humble Brony Bundle and all those projects raise so much money. That charity album, Smile, I don't know how much it raised, but it's quite a lot, quite a good amount. Bronies, they're loaded, I tell you. You can get a lot out of them, but don't exploit it, lah. The only thing is, Bronies are really caring people.
True.
Did you notice that? Yeah.
Yeah, true. We're a really cool bunch of people.
Yep.
It's for charity. Come on, just $5. Wouldn't hurt much.
Yeah.
Okay, on to the next topic. The royal wedding invitation. Daniel, give me a second. Someone's at the door.
Yeah, take your time.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Okay, I'm back.
Yeah, welcome back.
Guess what I have?
What's that?
The royal wedding invitation. In my hands.
Royal wedding? Whose royal wedding?
Well, let me open and see. You are cordially invited to the royal wedding of Princess Cadence and Shining Armor on Saturday the 21st of April, 2012 at 1 PM Eastern, 10 PM Pacific. Oh my god, I got an invitation! That's cool!
Are you serious? You're gonna miss ponies to go for a wedding?
I mean, it's Princess Cadence and Shining Armor, I mean, yeah!
But there's an episode at that time, are you gonna miss the episode for it?
Maybe. Oh, wait, there's something more. The invitation includes an invitation letter, of course, a DVD of both parts of the season finale.
Like, you got the DVD before me!
Yeah, I know! I won't miss the episode and I can go to a wedding! Cool!
I hate you.
I mean, I have to thank that grey Pegasus pony with blonde hair. Well, next time we give her a muffin then. Hasbro's been really hyping this up.
Yep, we can tell. I mean, even Paris Hilton covered it. I never expected to see the day that he would cover MLP on his blog. I think he cares about a lot of these kind of things. He may be very crude, and the way he does his blogging is very uptight and all that, but he's a great guy. I respect him.
The cool thing is, they really hype up the season finale for this.
Yeah, have you seen the billboard for it?
Yeah, it's on my last episode, episode 6. We talk about restaurants on that episode.
Oh.
Valhalla. They say that Thor served us food there. I'm not sure, but I would like to go there one day.
Yeah, count me in.
Okay, anyway, so Hasbro's really hyping this up. They've been sending invitations, DVDs.
I don't get one?
I don't know. I mean, maybe the Grey Pegasus sent it to the wrong place. I don't know. I'm not going to complain.
Fine, I understand. My place is pretty hard to find.
So anyway, Hasbro, they're really hyping this up.
Of course they are. I mean, it's a royal wedding. Who doesn't want to go for a royal wedding? I mean, I'm not interested in a royal wedding, but if there are ponies involved, I'm in.
I will go to this royal wedding. I will wear my best suit and all. Let's get into guest time. Today's guest is Daniel J. Christie, Jude Valentine Anthony, or Daniel for short.
You got it right.
That's a mouthful. He's the host for Lines, the unofficial Taylor's University podcast, and he's also the admin for Canterlot Campus, Taylor's University MLP Facebook group. Listen to him talk about his experience in podcasting and his life as a Brony in university. So, Daniel, you're the host for Lines, the unofficial Taylor's University podcast. What inspired you to start Lines, the unofficial Taylor's University podcast?
That's a very interesting question. You know, this is just the perfect show to talk about it. I actually was studying I'm actually studying broadcasting in Taylor's, and at the time last year, about September, when I became a Brony, I started exploring all the features, and I said, Bronies have really taken over the internet. Everything has been ponified. There's a Brony email service, there's a Brony news service, Equestria Daily and stuff. And then I noticed there's probably a podcast. And I looked, there were about 10 of them. You know, there's Electric Brony, there's Everfree Radio, and then I stumbled upon Bronyville.
Yes.
Brony Show, being one of the podcasts that I first listened to. It's one of the first podcasts I ever subscribed to, and I was very inspired by the way they work, because I look at it, it's 40 minutes, and I had this audio kind of TLDR going on in my head. I'm like, 40 minutes? I'm not going to listen to this. And on days when I drive to university and there's a traffic jam, if I borrow my mom's iPad, because my phone can't subscribe to podcasts, because it's not very good, I would plug it in, and I would play the podcast and listen to it, or plug in my laptop sometimes and listen to it on the car radio. And I realized this is one of the only shows in the world where I can sit down for 40 continuous minutes and listen to a bunch of people talking. Have you ever tried this on our local TV or Our local radio also, they play music, you know, that's the only way they can sustain people. They don't even play songs on Bronyville except for their intro and outro and sometimes in the middle.
No, they don't do much in the middle, actually. No.
They've only done it once or twice.
Really? For which episode? Because I listened to them.
One of the special episodes, they put in an RGB remix or something like that as an intermission song where they did a live show once.
Oh, that live show. Did you know how the existence of Magnet Pony came about?
Who?
Magnet Pony. It's a shirt. Okay, basically it's a Magneto Pony. It all came from that show, actually. The Bronyville show. They did the live show and it was at the final episode at the gala.
Oh, I see.
The best day ever. Yeah, sorry. The best day ever. AC, or Apple Cider, wanted to sing the song. The thing is, Magneto always pops up. Magneto from X-Men First Class.
Yeah.
He always pops up. So when they wanted to sing like at the gala, at something like that, and then like Magneto always pops up. So and then like AC modified the thing like at the gala with Magneto, something like that.
It first started with who? Spider-Man.
No, but Spider-Man never had his own shirt.
MLB in general started with Spider-Man starting coming in and doing all sorts of things. And then Deadpool started getting involved, and now Magneto?
Yeah, and Magneto has a pony shirt. I'm not kidding you.
What?
Really? Let me try and see if I can get it on, because it's on We Love Fine. I wish they would sponsor us.
But actually, continuing my story about the podcast, how it started, I asked my lecturer, you know, is there any way that we can practice our skills in broadcasting and writing broadcast medium scripts and all that, and he said there's currently nothing. That Dallas doesn't have a broadcast avenue. We don't even have a complete newsroom yet. And I asked him, can we start one? You know, and he said, if you can prove to us that you can do something, keep it sustained, then we look into it. So I started Lines. As a result of that, I took on the responsibility to take Taylor's to the internet. So basically, I thought, okay, I'm just gonna go in through all the news portals that Taylor's has, every single one of them, the student portal, the Facebook portal, the Twitter page, and every way that a Taylor can receive their news, and pull them all into one place and record it every weekend to give Taylor's students their news in a way that they don't need to have to go all the way to a website. Instead, they just plug in their headphones into a computer or an iPod and they just listen to, you know, instead of you reading it, have it read to you. It's something that saves time. So that when you're eating lunch, you can listen to it. You don't need to be in front of the computer.
True, I understand. And that's how this show came about, with that same concept of TLDR in mind.
Yep. I mean, Taylor's doesn't have much TLDR news. It's just that it's quite cluttered, actually, to be honest. And we all don't have a very habitual way of checking up on a student portal because we're all very Facebook people. Because of that, you know, we don't check any other site but Facebook, Twitter, and nowadays 9gag. And for Brony's Equestria Daily, we don't usually even go beyond that because we find it extremely tedious as students as well. The simple task of even logging in, typing your ID and password into that page, even that students find it tedious because Facebook remembers you. So I wanted to make something that's already so simple, but the tediousness of having to jump from one place to another because the news is a bit separated, that is what actually gets them.
From what I listened from your show, it was kind of interesting. Like, at the front where you say that, okay, we have this here from this company doing this, and then like, oh, we got also here and here and here. Like, I wish my college did that before. It was so cool.
I mean, this project, I mean, to make things clear, is currently not endorsed by Taylor's because it's still running unofficial. I am yet to receive endorsement from my lecturers. It's an unofficial project. It's a project that I run based on my time and it's my hobby. If it could be official, I would love it to be, here's the thing. Currently, I'm in the midst of upgrading my servers, so I'm bringing a whole new experience and I'm going to be presenting it to my lecturers again. Presented a couple of times, they still haven't been very
happy with the results.
Really that. They don't have time to look at it and stuff like that.
Well, that's not nice.
Yeah.
Okay, look at the link I send you. It's the Magneto shirt.
Ah, okay. Wow.
Yep.
You know, because We Love Fine, really, it's the only, if I'm not mistaken, it's the shirt shop that has the monopoly on MLP merchandise licensing for Bronies.
Not really that. All their MLP shirts are official Hasbro license.
Yeah, that's why. They are licensed. The reason is, We Love Fine has almost a monopoly on that.
Mm, Not really. Yeah. Some other sites have sell some pony shirts, but
it's close enough.
Yeah, but the thing is, some other sites, they only sell like one or two.
Wheel of Fun is the ultimate repository. It's all there.
They've been featured on EQD, they've been featured on Bronyville, they've been featured on Derby Hoof News. Like,
it's how they get there because of their good PR, because when you care about your customers, there are some places that don't care about customers. There are a lot of cartoon shows, especially in the G3 season, when, of course, Hasbro admitted, you know, that, you know, sometimes they were sick of having a show that was exclusively for kids. Was described as, by people as extremely outrageously girly. So, you know, when you start to care about the people who watch your show, that's when everything turns around. People, and not even a show, think about it in a wider business perspective. If you care about your customers, everything changes.
I totally agree. On to the next question. What made you create Canterlot Campus?
Okay, Canterlot Campus, it wasn't a very serious project to begin with, because I was the usual kind of brony in Malaysia, and I thought, am I the only one? That's the first thing I thought, because I didn't go through the 5 stages of bronyism. Neither was someone trying to convert me. So I went through the phase which, am I the only brony in the world? And then when I found Canterlot Forums, then I thought, am I the only brony in Malaysia? And then I uncovered the Bronies of Malaysia Facebook page, and I thought, that's it! And that's when I found MBS, and that's when I found, oh, there are actually Bronies in Malaysia, there are actually active Bronies in Malaysia. That's when I met Imran Teo, who was co-hosting me on the episode of Lines that featured Bronyism. He actually found me, because I was like, he actually asked me, so, hey, you're from Taylor's, Yeah, I'm from Taylor's. You don't know me, man? Yeah, you hear my voice every day outside the student center, I'm talking nonsense outside there. I said, oh, that's you.
And then how friendship was discovered.
Yeah, that's how friendship was discovered. And actually, before that already, I established Canterlot Campus because I thought there could be potential, maybe in Taylor's or Brony's. I don't know. It was just like a punch in the air. And there were only like two or three of us in it to start. And then I started trying to get my classmates to watch. They watch, but they're not active Brony's. They're not committed to the fandom, but they watch. Some of them watch religiously, like every Saturday night episode comes out, Sunday morning they already watched it. But they still aren't bronies, as they're not committed to the fandom. They won't do anything more than just watch.
So, what was the reaction of the other students when you made Canterlot Campus?
It depends, because some students, in Taylor's, I've been trying to start societies for a while, trying to get students together on common interests. I used to be a member of the Society of Communication, but that club hasn't been performing very well of late because most of the members have graduated. We're still trying to get up on our feet. What happened is that there's definitely a place in Taylor's for bronies, because if you look at other universities across the world, schools, university, high schools, colleges, even primary schools, there are people who have gotten together their own brony society within university. And in USA, if I'm not mistaken, it's Stony Brook University. They have a brony society called Pony Brook University. And on the weekend, they're a liberal arts college. Now, liberal arts colleges, they like to let students go all out in any way possible to explore their inner creative self. That's when they turn their whole campus into a canvas where you can take chalk, as long as it's chalk, draw anywhere you want. Draw on the ground, on the pavement, on the brick wall. You can make it to the ceiling, go up. Of course, bronies who are skilled in art, they took advantage of this. And, you know, you walk by, suddenly there's this, probably the library block on the corner, and there's Pinkie walking with you like that. They make really, really great wall street art. I mean, the next day it's just washed down, you know, it's easy to wash off, so you can start doing it again the next weekend. And I thought, okay, maybe we won't go that far here, but there's potential. Students plus bronyism, because naturally, me as a brony, I want to give back to the community for what bronyism has taught me in the first place, and that's friendship and magic. That's why the tagline for Canterlot Campus is love, friendship and magic.
Is Canterlot Campus well received?
Not really. We can call it almost like a beta testing stage. It's still out there testing the water, trying to get attention. And if you're listening to this and you're at Taylor's University, you can come and join us. You know, the URL to join the group in the show notes. You can head on in and join the group. We'll approve you, no problem. Just have to request, because we don't want too many non-Taylorians inside. And non-Taylorians doesn't mean that, you know, graduates can't enter. We accept there are graduates in the group. There are ex-Taylorians. They're Taylor's alumni. If you're from Taylor's College, Taylor's Subang, Taylor's Hatamas, Taylor's Lakeside, we don't care. As long as you're Taylorian, you're more than welcome to join us. we had screenings last year in the V restaurant. The V restaurant is only vegetarian restaurant in Taylor's University, situated underneath the Starbucks coffee. It's a Brony-friendly cafe because last year, the boss actually approached me when I booked the place for a screening because I wanted to use the projector. And he asked us, what's the show? And I said, oh, it's My Little Pony Friendship is Magic. And he asked me why we're watching it here. And I said, it's not available on Astro. And we want to share this with others. So we all come here and watch it together. He actually was very open to it. He liked the idea. I mean, unfortunately, now they changed management. But The new management is also liking it as well.
Did he sit down and watch it too?
No, he was pretty busy. But we got some attention, good and bad. People have asked to turn it off. People have asked us to turn down the volume. Even though it's so soft, we can't even hear it ourselves. You know, we're looking there and trying to read Rainbow Dash's lips.
I don't think cartoon works that way.
It doesn't work very well, you know. And then you start having fun by trying to give them dialogue.
That's always fun. So, What kind of activities do you usually do?
Aside from screening, well, we don't usually do many activities because we're still very small, very young. But in store for this club, we have a lot of things underway. Like, to start, we're going to definitely have screenings. We're going to go up to forums because deep within MLP episodes, we can decode and dig deeper and find... There's not just a friendship lesson in every episode. Surely, okay, there's a letter to Celestia and that's at the end. If you dig deeper, like especially one of the latest episodes, Ponyville Confidential, you know that episode, right?
Yep.
I, as a communication student, it outlined my entire semester 2 media writing course in one episode. If you watch the episode, you will see the lesson come to life in front of your eyes. And that's a communication student's perspective. Everything from using pen names, deadline, how you are faced with the dilemma when you are asked to challenge your editor for ethical use of your work. Everything is there. It's just presented to you in ponies. It's easy to understand. And it's great, that's the thing. And what happened is that it would be great if we could get people to dig in and talk about this. So we're hoping to maybe have a Brony forum sometime, a discussion on episodes, air an episode, get even lecturers to talk about it. Our ultimate goal, our ultimate aim is to give back to the community in so many in ways that are like many things. We've considered things like blood donation drives and charity events. Of course, none of these are actually on the agenda yet because we're still young. But this is, of course, our dream to go and give back to the community the same way that the show has impacted our lives. If you remember on MBS a few months ago, actually, I made a promise, and this promise still stands. If I can find 30 committed, loving, and very, very friendly, not to say friendly, I would say, okay, committed to the show, 30 in Taylor's University, give me your names, give me your numbers. You can just join the group, hit me up, Facebook message me, and tell me that you're committed about this. All I need is 30, and the promise still stands. I will see that BronyCon Malaysia happens.
Listen to that, folks. If you're Taylors and you want to see BronyCon happen, join Canterlot Campus.
Every year there are events. The Anime Society has their Asaban Festival. The engineering students have the engineering fair. And I thought, if we have a club, we need to have something every year as well. Something that we can be looked upon. Because I believe that there are many, many closet bronies in Malaysia who still haven't come out yet. Come on, Singapore has 400 of them and we have 200. I don't believe that. You know, there's many, many more who still haven't come out of their shell.
But the challenge here right now is, Danielle, you're challenging people from Taylors. So that's going to be a hard challenge.
No, but taking it from that perspective, Taylor's has an enrollment of about, if I'm not mistaken, 7,000 students at the time being. And we only have, 13 members in Canterlot Campus? No, wait, the current number is about 21. But at one stage, we only had 13, and we thought, if Singapore is so small, the population is probably, 5 million, and they have 400. There's definitely more in Taylor's who just have not come out yet. Or they're just people in Taylor's with so much potential to be bronies and they're not there yet. You know, people who are waiting to discover. And we want to be the people who bring these people to the light of bronies. No, we're not. We don't mean it like some religious conversion manner or anything. Ponies are things worth sharing. Canterlot Campus is open to staff, lecturers and all that. You know, we don't limit it to students because most clubs, you know, they think, student only. No, we are open. You want to be your janitor also, you can join us. Don't worry, no problem.
Okay, that's going to be an interesting brony there.
Yep.
Now on to the MBS member question. And, I think this guy is appropriate for he is not here now. Emilio Daniel asked, why is your name so long?
Okay, fine. A lot of people like to ask me this question, and I usually like to give the answer because ponies, but that's totally irrelevant. So, actually, my full name is Daniel J.R. Christie Anthony. That's my IC name. I'm Catholic, and at the age of 17, I received sacrament of confirmation in my church. And at 17 or 18 or 16 in some denominations, Catholics, you know, you're supposed to choose a new name because you're taking on a new life. You've graduated from Catechism Sunday School. You're supposed to take on a new name. So I chose Jude Valentine, combining the virtues of St. Jude and St. Valentine. So yeah, I just slotted that into my name like all of us did in the whole class. And surprisingly, I don't have the longest name in my class.
Oh, really? No?
Yeah, you know, there's one girl who has a longer name than me.
Okay. Well, so your name is not long then.
Oh, it's long. But I have friends with longer names.
So Stephanie Tan asks, is Emilio your long-lost twin brother?
You know, Stephanie, when I first saw his picture, I thought the same thing. That's why I uploaded that picture about that Gillette advertisement. I'm serious. I looked at him and I'm like, where did this guy get my picture from? And I've never worn a suit in my life. The last time I wore a suit, it was for... I have to wash the British Morning Orchestra. That was the first and last time I ever wore a suit in my life. I don't even have a suit in my house that fits me at the moment. So I'm like, okay, this dude is obsessed with suits. Giving me a bad name. What's this guy's name? And I said, Daniel as well? Okay, fine. I didn't know that. Okay, he's a musician. My mind exploded at that moment.
I wish our co-host here would be here to explain himself, but...
Yeah, I would love to actually talk to him about that.
Well, maybe next time. Emilio is not your twin brother then?
Nope.
Darn it.
Well, we have totally different blood, you know. I'm Chinese-Indian and he's, I don't know, Malay Portuguese or something, he says.
Yeah, I don't know. He never told me anything about that.
So, any more questions for me about my name, about who I am or anything like that?
Well, don't think so. We can move on to the next topic. And this week, we have an email!
I wish my podcast had emails. Nobody emails me. Half the time, my phone rings because, you know, I wire my podcast email, which is landsandgraduation.com, to my phone. And every time I ring, I'm so excited and I pick it up, and then suddenly there'll be like Daniel and Jimson, one of your tweets.
Oh, never mind. You'll get some email on your show one day.
Soon.
Daniel, you want to read this or should I?
Okay, I think I'll read it. Looks pretty interesting. Oh, this one's from Muffy Derp. Oh, a couple of times he's emailed us already.
Yay!
Okay. Let's see. Dear MBS show people, I like the news you review. Yay! I can hardly make out what Emilio is saying. Ooh, come on, Emilio really needs to buy a new mic. Jimmy is an awesome brony to have as a guest. How about directly linking the videos you talk about with him? The ones you said inspired his work? Oh, Jimmy has inspiration. Oh, that guy works on pure brain, what do you call it?
Brain fuel.
Think tank. Yeah, brain fuel is total think tank. He's amazing, you know. I really love Jimmy. I totally agree with Jimmy Lee on his opinion of the Brony community. Well said, mature comments, and so the claps well deserved. Friendship is magic.
Hey, thank you.
Jimmy thinks the show has some serious points. I agree. But in that rarity and spike scene, I think emotional was a better word to describe it. To be honest, I didn't like that episode, but yeah.
You didn't like the episode?
No, for some reason I don't like spike episodes.
If you're Rarity/Spike fan, big person.
Oh, I see. Yeah, it meant something la. I mean, even Dragon Quest, I didn't really like it that much.
But actually, there's
only said bottom three of my main six. Yeah,
there's a fanfic I really like. It's called Where Pony.
Ah, okay.
Synopsis is Spike turns into a pony and Rarity is in love with Pony Spike.
Wow. Now I understand where all the fan art of Spike as a pony came out suddenly. It's just sudden influx of that.
Could be, I don't know.
Jimmy doesn't need to apologize for the late videos. He doesn't own us as viewers or anything. His video will be done when it's done. Yeah, Jimmy, don't rush. You know, we can wait.
I'm excited for that Final Fantasy VII scene he's talking about.
Yeah, I mean, of course, we would love to see it faster, but no, don't rush it. You know, it's a work of art and you're doing a great job. Don't rush it. Don't rush it.
Okay, and hope to see episode 7 soon. Muffins and Cupcakes, Muffy Derp. Thanks a lot, Muffy. You like the news review? Thank you. We try to do our best. And
you're doing a great job, I must say. Cause, you know, I it's similar concept to how Lions runs, because news and all is something that is hard to find, especially in the Brony community. You need news from Equestria really tries their best to aggregate all of it in one place. And because we can pull news from all other places, especially regional news around this area. Because I can't remember who's that clown at Brony Con who said that, you know, oh, we don't see Asian Bronies being active.
The professor something, I don't remember his name.
Yeah, that guy, you know, like, we don't see Asian Bronies being active. And I tell you, people like us were very, very angry.
To defend him, the reason why he didn't see us active, because, well, we're not active.
Well, that does depend. Think about projects like Pony Hoof.
Actually, that came out after.
Yeah, it came out way after, but things like this have been under development, and people have been contributing. They have, SBS has done some stuff. The Philippine Brony Convention that's coming up, that was a project that was way underway before even BronyCon.
To his defense, playing devil's advocate here. Okay, when he did his analysis, it was before all this happened. So when he say Asian Bronies are not active, what does he mean by that?
Yeah, good question.
Let's just say SBS, the Singapore Brony Society, did something, did an event, and it's considered to be a hit for Singaporeans.
Yeah.
And the Malaysian Brony Society did something, like the Comic Fiesta thing. But
yeah.
Did it punch any holes to count itself as Asia?
The question is that, you know, we probably aren't that active, but I don't think the word inactive is really the appropriate term, because we have been featured on EQD up to the stage. I mean, Draw Friend, of course, we have great, great people like Sonder and Vincent, and if I'm missing anyone, I'm really
Joey.
Sorry, who contribute so much to that. And we have been in on the nightly roundups really a lot of times already. And even Statisto said, these guys are crazy. We had 3 meetups in 1 month.
Yeah, but that thing, is it before or after his analysis of BronyCon? See, that's the
throughout,
whole thing.
It was throughout. We have been on nightly roundups for a long time, and we owe a lot of it to one of our members who writes all our write-ups for us. And it's been like that because we write up, we send it to EQD, and I've known bronies from other countries who don't write up about their meetups, you know?
True. So that's
we're one of the only countries who actually do it.
Yeah, so that's the question then. Does he count it active as in a certain percent or as the Asia in general? So that's the whole thing.
The words he used, if I'm not mistaken, was, I have not seen. I mean, honestly, to be frank, has he really done his research on it? Because maybe, okay, if you're an average Joe, you know, it just comes out, okay, I haven't seen any of this. Maybe you're not really doing, you don't have much access maybe to EQD or something like that. But if you're a professor who really does in-depth analysis on this and you actually go into how the demographic of these shows hit this part of the world, you would know that we are actually a little active. You know, you should do your work. You should do your homework on it.
True. No defending him there.
I mean, you have a point about us not being that active, and that's very true.
It's his definition of active. Like, I can say that I don't like vegetable, but you see me eating vegetable. So, like, what are you doing? I thought you don't like vegetable. And they're like, oh, I do, but it's certain vegetables.
Generalization thing.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people like me, of course, people like me, I'm a bit, like, hyper, like, picky. I jump to conclusions, so you know, when you said that, I was like, what?
I mean,
are you kidding me?
I don't know, but it's his word against ours, so
yeah.
Whatever then. So anyway, I'm on to Emilio. I can't hardly make out what Emilio is saying. Well, he's not here to defend himself, so I will not say anything on his behalf. So anyway, about linking Derek's inspirational works, well, I'll try if I can remember what he said. And, well, I think that's about it. If you have any questions, concerns, or suggestions for the show, you can contact us at thembsshow@gmail.com. Daniel, thank you. It was a pleasure having you on the show.
Thank you very much for having me over. And guys, remember, if you're from Taylor's University or if you know anyone in Taylor's University who is a Brony, tell them about Canterlot Campus. We need members because we are going to turn Taylor's University upside down.
I've been Norman Sanzo.
And I'm Daniel Anthony.
We'll see you next week.
Yeah, when I trot on by, I smile like Pinkie as a filly say hi. Listen to Pony Beats, checking out the fan out on EQD, yeah. This is how we roll, love and tolerate out of control. Bro Hoof Dusty with his big ass mo and Alex S rocking out the club, yow. Girl, do you watch Pony? Girl, do you watch Pony? Girl, do you watch Pony? I do now! A girl, do you watch Pony? A girl, do you watch Pony? A girl, do you watch Pony? I do now when I trot to the gala. This is what I see, a whole herd of ponies that wanna party with me. I got nothing on my flank, but I ain't afraid to show it, show it, show it, show it. I'm Brony and I know it. I'm Brony and I know it. Bro hoof say what? When I'm at the mall, scalp line bags gotta buy them all. And when I'm in the gym, I'm copping flack cause I watch Fem, what? But that's how I roll, come on bronies, ignore the trolls. Switching on the hub, make six a dart, no toes, no thumbs, and they still beat Discord, what? Girl, check out my ponies. Girl, check out my ponies. Girl, check out my ponies. She's like, wow. Girl, check out my ponies. Girl, check out my ponies. Girl, check out my ponies. She's like, wow, when I canter to the meetup. This is what I see, a massive group of bronies, they're ready to party. I got dashy on my belt, and I'm not afraid to show it, show it, show it, show it. I'm brony and I know it. I'm brony and I know it. Giggle, giggle, giggle with the ghosty, yeah. Giggle, giggle, giggle with the ghosty, yeah. Giggle, giggle, giggle with the ghosty, yeah. Giggle with the ghosty, yeah, yeah, yeah. Just giggle, man. Come on, giggle, man. Yeah. I'm brony and I know it. Who doesn't watch Pony? Who doesn't watch Pony? Who doesn't watch Pony? You do now. Who doesn't watch Pony? Who doesn't watch Pony? Who doesn't watch Pony? You do now. I'm brony and I know it.